We're going to take a close-up look at vintage handheld telescopes with the aim of helping you to identify them and appreciate them. Brought you into one of our inner sanctums here. We normally have an optical bench set up in this room, but we've cleared a bit of space so that we can talk about vintage telescopes and binoculars. Let's just kick off by showing you a very typical instrument from, and here's the rub. I can't date this precisely for you because there's no maker's name on it, and it follows a pattern that was really popular from the end of the 19th century to well into the 20th century. And this is a three-draw portable telescope. And incidentally, you count the draw tubes on this. This isn't a four, this is a three. You actually count the draw tubes coming out of the main body. Now, the thing about this instrument, it follows a configuration that you'll actually see appearing on telescopes from really halfway through the 17th century. Telescopes after about 1660 started looking increasingly like this. And then all the way into the 20th century. This is typical of one. I would have thought this is around about 1900, this particular one here. It's got quite a nice number of features. It's got this flared eyepiece holder with a built-in shutter. We've got a very typical type of cap from the front of it here, and it's leather covered. At the front end, we've got an achromatic lens. That's a lens with two components. And inside here, we'll take it apart or something like this in just a moment. You can see inside it. We've got a relay lens system here that erects the image, and then we've got a field lens and then an eye lens at the back end here. And one of the nice things about these type of telescopes, when you get them, when you've had a chance to clean up the barrels and clean any of the debris away from the couplers just here, they should make this sound a bit like cracking knuckles when you actually open and close them. So let's go back in time now and show you something really much older. These are all telescopes that we've accumulated, so there's going to be lots of gaps here in this presentation, because these are really based on instruments that we've got in our collection, rather than perfect steps in a chronology. But this is a good one to kick off with. This is a probably a British made instrument from about 1750. It's got some features that are really quite important. We've got a single draw tube at the back end of the telescope. We've got this conical shaped eyepiece holder where the eyepiece actually gets thinner as it comes out. We've got a built-in guillotine there, so quite different to the other telescope that I just showed you. This very simple guillotine styling. Now look at the front end. Big telescope, quite wide, but when we actually open it up, we've got a really tiny lens cell at the front here. In fact, I'm going to open this up so that you can have a look at it. Incidentally, this tube, this is not laminated. This wooden tube here is entirely manufactured from one piece of timber. It's beautifully made. I think you can see that. The end caps here have been riveted into place, so they've actually got little brass pins that have been put on and then have been peened over to hold it up. And we haven't tried to restore this, and it's a little bit loose at the end there. But when it was made, the actual engineering connection here, it's really beautifully done, the way it's been put together. I'm actually going to disassemble this, and I'm going to do it on the mouse pad here to show you. So there's the lens cell, and it gets even worse when we look at the rear retaining element there. This piece of brass that's been screwed on, we can see the lens, and that's something along the lines of about 8 millimeters in diameter, on the internal diameter there. So this really quite large looking telescope turns out to have a clear aperture of only 8 millimeters. Now if I undo that, and I'm going to be very gentle, actually not that gentle, with the eye lens, we can see we haven't really tried to do much with this by way of restoring it or anything, but you can see we've got a really quite large lens relative to the size of that hole. So what's going on there then? We've got this very tiny aperture and a great big lens. Well, although they were quite good at making this kind of lens and were able to do quite a good job on getting a good sharp image, and incidentally the image through this telescope in strong light really is excellent. It's sharp, There's a lot of detail. There's not much false colour, even though this is a single element lens. And the hole is really the key. That small aperture is the key to understanding how they managed to keep the colour away. It's this greatly reduced aperture. So turning this into a very high F ratio telescope. So the number of times you can divide that into the focal length of this. So obviously the focal length of this instrument, you can see the relay lens system is down here, eyepiece down here. It really is quite long. So this has got a very high F ratio. Now it's this aperture that enables the spherical aberration. So the tendency of the edge performance of the lens to be really quite poor and to soften and distort the image, and also the color error that comes from having a single lens like this. So you can see this is really quite an extraordinary, it looks like we're being conned here. We've got a nice big telescope, but when it really comes down to it, the engine is really tiny. So let's look at the eyepiece end of this in a bit more detail and see if we can get the go of it. I'm going to gently unscrew the assembly, the draw tube assembly off the rear end there, and you can see that. And you can actually see the woodwork of the tube inside there. You know, and let's keep reminding ourselves, it's made in 1750. So this really is a relic from a past that's really still quite difficult for us to understand. One of the great things I think about collecting and looking at this type of instrument is there's a beautiful buzz that you can get in looking through it and admiring the fact that it works as well today as it did when they made it in 1750-odd. The people that made it are long gone, but the telescope endures still. So let's look at this tube in a bit more detail. The coupling at the front here has got these very thin, fine cuts in it to give it a little bit of spring tension. So we've got a little bit of gappiness at the end. Some of that's probably wear after all these years, but it still actually holds onto this really quite nicely. We've got an end stop on here to stop the draw tube pulling out. But don't be too surprised if you find one of these without this element. There were various methods used of attaching this. Sometimes it was soldered on, sometimes it was folded back, and sometimes it wasn't there at all. So don't go thinking that just because it hasn't got this structure that it's actually broken or missing a part, because sometimes with these very older 18th century telescopes, it's not unheard of for this not to be there at all, and they actually allowed the draw tube to be pulled all the way out. So do bear that in mind. This particular instrument has a five-piece, five-element eyepiece and a recting system. And I'm just going to show you those separate barrels now. It actually separates at the front end here. So this is a very complicated draw tube. I'm just going to take it down into its component parts. Let's just put them in order so that we can put it all back together again. It's all beautifully turned and it fits together as well now as it did. So there's the eyepiece cap, and you can see that's quite a nicely made. This piece actually unscrews, but it's a little bit on the tight side, so I'm not actually going to take that apart, but you can see that's very nicely made. And we can see the eyepiece element here on the end. One of the things that always impresses me is they really did intend that the user might want to clean the instrument themselves, and every part has got a little knurled edge to it to help you take it to pieces. We've also got a field stop in this eyepiece as well, built in there. So obviously now this is the eye lens, then we have a field lens coupled with that one, and I'll just show you very quickly. I'm not going to take the lens out in case we injure it in some way, but we've got a very nicely turned retaining ring there. Later on it will be become commonplace practice, and it's another one of those things you can use to differentiate a telescope between an early one made in the early part of the 1700s to a later one. It will become a trend to put the lens in permanently into this cell and have a very fine turned brass edge to it, and actually turn it over onto the lens with a piece of wood while it's turning to actually spin it in to the cell to hold the lens in. Obviously one of the problems with that is when we've got a damaged one or something wrong with it, we've usually got to part it off to actually get it apart, and that normally does permanent damage to the cell, and it's quite a difficult technique to actually replicate. Let's just put that back together again. So that goes together with the eyepiece lens. So now that's our eyepiece assembly, basically, with the eye lens and the field lens. with this particular telescope, this configuration here with two more lenses normally makes up the Sherrill relay system, named after the, I think he was Czechoslovakian, the gentleman who first came up with that idea. So this is the Erector lens set. That would be these two lenses together. But this particular instrument's actually got another, a fifth lens, that goes at the intermediate focus point in between the first image point, that goes in between it here. So this is a five lens eyepiece system with this telescope. And once it's all together, you know, it's almost difficult. You can't feel these joints here. They're so beautifully done. So, mid 18th century technology, and goodness, what's that got to do with us today? Well, you might be surprised. There are a few places where you're still likely to encounter that same idea. It's in something like this, possibly, a small finderscope. If I take this apart, you'll see that we've got something that looks very similar to the telescope we were just looking at. Here we go. Nice big lens, about 20 millimeters, but when we look inside the tube, we can see that we've got an 8 millimeter aperture stop there, and that's a permanent part of the instrument's tube. Now again, this is a single non-achromatic lens, and of course, in exactly the way that we saw with that English-made mid-18th century telescope, they're using this to get rid of spherical aberration and chromatic error, and it works as well today as it did all those hundreds of years ago. And you're likely to encounter this on a low-cost starter telescope, quite simply. And also, if you go into a toy shop and buy a small telescope for a child, you're also probably likely to encounter the same idea. Got this big end at the front here, and even the conical eyepiece, it actually looks like a mid-18th century telescope. And if we take it apart, we've got exactly the same idea. We just take this off. There's our single element lens on the inside, and there's the aperture stop in exactly the same way. So you can see, mid-18th century technology, still part of the Chinese economic miracle today. Mm-hmm.